Let's do this.
You got it?
Yeah.
All right. Hey, welcome to this week's episode. My name is Joon.
And I'm Christine. Let's get ready to rock your biz.
Okay, so really important episode, as always. This one actually comes a lot in when people say, like, you know, I'm not making as much money as I should, or, you know, maybe people don't know I'm as good at my job as I think I am. And I always turn that back and go, you have a credibility issue. And so this week's episode is on how to dramatically increase your credibility.
And it might not be a credibility issue, it's that they didn't ever know how to establish it in the first
absolutely,
place.
Absolutely.
So a good way is a book, right?
Yeah, book, ebook. I mean, who can't do that?
A blog, but I mean, to me, I think a lot of people could do blogs. Right. They're pretty easy to do. So I think a book takes it to that next level. Mm-hmm. And self-publishing.
Although there's a lot of people that want to do blogs and just never do them.
Yeah.
Like consistently. This is the measure for if you want to start a blog, let me see 3 months later that you're still doing it.
Exactly. Right? And that's a good measure of credibility is, are you a consistent person, right?
Yep. Yeah.
I think when I think of somebody being credible, it's, where, you know, do they do what they say they're going to do? Do they, you know, if they're posting blogs, are they doing it consistently? They're not just like doing it here.
Did it once like in 89.
Yeah.
Or like 99 when
it was
awesome.
Not doing it at all and then doing it. So, yeah, I think that, you know, a book is huge credibility, and it's a lot easier than people make it out to be, especially with Amazon CreateSpace. That's their self-publishing company.
Yeah.
You can easily do it through there, and then that's like, that's
yeah, and Seth Godin helped launch that. I think it was a subset of CreateSpace. It was basically like they just approached him directly, hey, your blog is the most, you know, highly trafficked blog on the line. Would you want to do a self-published book? And he's like, yeah, I don't know why I don't need publishers anymore.
So which book did he
sell? Poke the Box, his most recent one.
I didn't know that.
And that one was great because he actually launched that with no title. He just put the icon because he believed that the online marketing is so different. He's like, books don't need titles anymore. Here's just a picture. So for the year and a half he was promoting that book, you didn't know what the title was. It was just the picture of the dude in Poke the Box. It wasn't until it came out that you actually knew what the title was.
That was
the crazy thing about that. But yeah, think about it. I don't know, like, there's people in the publishing industry are big on, like, you still need to get picked up with this big publisher or whatnot. Doesn't matter.
No.
I mean, when you buy a book from someone, you're like, oh, that's not Simon & Schuster, sorry. Or like, you
exactly.
know, like, oh, that's Penguin Youth Division, come on. Like, no one's reading that kind of stuff going, oh, that's like a, you know, as long as it doesn't look like a cheesy hand cutout cover.
Yeah.
You know,
and I think especially with depending on your industry and what you're doing, I think credibility is huge.
Yeah.
Huge.
Yeah.
What are some other ways that
I think, you know, obviously like a podcast like this, like, you know, obviously we put some production value in this, but I mean, most people, you can just pop open your laptop, right? And do, as long as it's, the big thing you mentioned is consistent.
Yeah.
As long as, if you say you're doing a weekly show, guess what? It's got to come out every week.
Exactly.
or else it's no good. You know, that's actually why I haven't done a blog. Because I was like, you know, I found a blog, I'm going to do a post on Tuesday and Thursday of every week. And I said, when am I going to, I don't have time to do that.
Yeah,
you know?
How are
but
you going to make sure you can do that?
I just recently bought that Dragon Naturally Speaking software. And so what it does, is it takes you, you can move a voice file of like this recording, and you can put it in this folder, and it'll automatically dictate it for you. It's pretty awesome.
Whoa,
you have to train it. You have to train it for your, like, your diction and stuff like that, but it's really cool.
What about any cuss words that you might say?
Yeah, throw that in there. I will.
It
turns into some, like, diplomat's name or something like that.
No, yeah. Usually it's a little symbol. Last time, the older version was little funky symbols. It was funny.
And you have some experience in this, like awards and stuff like that, right?
Yeah.
What most people don't know is what about awards?
You can self-nominate.
Almost every award that is, like, impressive, they're all self-nominations, people.
Yeah, because if you're going to wait around for somebody
to nominate. It's either you or your agent nominating you for it.
Yeah,
that's basically what it is.
Your PR firm that you work
your
with.
Intern. It's like the same people who are filling out Wikipedia pages for you. It can't be you. It's just like some other random person.
Yeah, and that's a huge way to get also credibility. You can put in your email signature that you've won that award. You can put it on your LinkedIn page. You're going to put it, you know,
just gives you another excuse to even reach out to your customers, too.
Oh, yeah,
hey,
to
we won this award, you know. And that's the thing is I think some of us are so like, oh, I have to nominate myself. Guys, that's kind of the way it is.
I think
you need to get over that. You need to get over that.
They're too busy, these days to take the time, which is unfortunate, but,
I remember I was doing something in my kid's school, and I didn't nominate myself. I didn't vote for, like, someone had nominated me, and then you had to kind of fill in your application materials to actually be taken seriously. And then when it came to voting, I think I lost by, like, 2 votes. It's, you know, super small school. And then someone's like, and I told someone, well, I voted for you. And he's like, why didn't you vote for yourself? I'm like, who votes for themselves? It was just so weird, you know?
No, I don't vote at all. No, someone, I was competing in something. They said, well, you voted for yourself, right? And I said, no, I just think it's bad karma. So I don't vote at all.
Right, right. But that's different. When you're going for awards, you really have to nominate yourself. And here's the whole point is that no matter how awesome or like, you know, like grassroots the award is, there is going to be some other third party that's looking at it. And if you're not worthy, they're just not going to give it to you. They're not stupid, you know? And so no matter how corrupt or unexpert those people are, there's still a third party looking at your application. At the very least, they're judging your application versus someone else's application, going, this person filled it out, this person didn't, they win.
they filled it out correctly, the other person didn't.
You know? But I mean, think about it, like awards, like impressive things like Inc. 5000, you have to nominate yourself. Inc. magazine isn't like trolling through the country looking for, oh, you'd be a good candidate for Inc. 5000.
Dude, in my other Cleanology could have been on the dang list, and I didn't even know.
Easy.
I thought they went out and found
No. They don't do that. Who has time for that, too? And also, like, locally, the San Diego Business Journal. Any business journal, they have special lists of industries. You would have easily been number one for every single year you would have been in business.
Yeah, I didn't know you put your... Yeah. I mean, I know that now, but...
No, so go look it up. I think everyone should aspire to, maybe
like
not.
The fastest growing company.
Yeah, I mean, it depends on what you want. I think the Inc. 5000, obviously, we're rewarding aggressive growing companies, you know, privately held companies is what their thing is. But look at their criteria. It's like, it's pretty substantial. You have to make a certain dollar amount, and you have to jump from year to year to year. So it's hard. Once you make it, it's hard to stay on that list. You know, so that's like one of our clients. They've been on the list for like 4 years. You're like, wow.
Oh, cool.
That is really hard to do. You know, to go from like $100,000 to like $800,000, that's pretty impressive. But, you know, it's easier to do because you're only making $100,000 as a company, whatever. But once you hit like $3 or $4 million, it's hard to keep growing by like 50-60%. It's really tough.
The bigger the number,
Self-nominate yourself. And it's interesting. Like when you win an award, it's not the reason people are gonna hire you. But it doesn't hurt.
Yeah.
Right? You know, when you see someone's award, you're thinking like, oh, they did good at something.
And it's the credibility. Yeah. It's not like they just stepped onto the scene, right? They didn't just start doing this yesterday. Yeah. If you start building up the credibility. I mean, I see people, especially online, with online businesses that just rapidly have acquired, you know, awards and just testimonials and all sorts of stuff, and they haven't been at it very long, but it makes them look like they've been doing it for years.
Right. Well, and because here's the reality. Like, think about this. If you were working in a certain job for another company and now you're doing your own thing, you might actually have a much longer professional experience than your company has been around. You know, you might have been doing it for 20 years, but 19 of those years were for someone else's company. So you might very well be capable of winning all these awards. Now you're under your own banner. So yeah, you've only been in business for a year, but you've been doing it for 20 years. I mean, how are you measuring that kind of stuff? And so, like, I think for you, what was impressive is, I think, what was it? Was it a couple of years ago, the SBA award?
2009.
So it wasn't Women Entrepreneur of the Year. It was SBA Small Business of the Year or something.
Business Person of the Year.
That was pretty cool. Think about that. No one can ever take that away from you, right?
Yeah. No,
it's... I mean, that's always going to be there.
No, you know? Yeah. And I had to read the letter three times over because I thought it was either young business, because they have different categories.
Yeah.
So the smaller categories are like Women Business Owner of the Year. So I thought maybe it was for that. Or Young Entrepreneur of the Year.
Yeah.
Which is under 35.
No, but you got the most general one. I was like, whoa.
Business Person of the Year. I'm like, wait, did they mix me up?
Yeah, when I read the SBA announcement, I was like, oh, Christine won like Women Young Entrepreneur of the Year or something like that. I'm like, oh, no. That's like just like Business Person of the Year. Pretty cool.
Yeah, it was way cool.
I also know the guy, I think it was that year or the year after you, that he won like the Small Business of the Year award. His company was doing $50 million. And you're like, seriously?
I saw that.
I was like, really? That's Small Business of the Year?
Yeah. Awesome, you know? Whoa, that's he was doing probably right under 50. $50 million is usually the
cap. When he won the award, like basically in the application period,
he was under. It's months.
He was under that. But when he got the award.
He wasn't a small business.
Yeah, when he got the award, I was talking to him like, you know, everyone in this room hates you because you're doing like 50 to 60.
He started a small business.
Yeah, but he started a small business, but it's pretty
That
cool.
is the definition. I always look that up. Yeah. I think that's always funny that a small business is anything under $50 million a year. And I'm like, dang,
it's a certain number of employees, too, right?
I think it's 500.
500 if you're manufacturing, like 50 if you're like a service or something.
But yeah, $49 million a year business to me is not a small business, but I mean that's
you'd be surprised,
best
man.
Case definition.
There are a lot of businesses, especially here in San Diego, because we draw a lot of like lifestyle entrepreneurs, that we get a lot of people that they're doing like $120 million a year. But if you walked into the office and saw the culture, they run like a small business. They're just like mom and pop still.
And
you're like, you guys are making $120 million. Like, you know, whatever. We don't know how what's happening. You're like, okay.
That's you know? Cool. That's fine.
Yeah, you know, and you can have large companies that run small, and you have small companies that run very big as far as their operations and stuff as well. Another a good credibility, and this one is, I think, the most democratic because it's free for everybody, is LinkedIn.
Yeah, you know? That's a great one.
Because the one they've always had is the recommendation tool where I can recommend you, you can recommend me. Now, one of my pet peeves is I get a lot. I get probably like 3 a week.
Hey,
would you recommend me?
The generic
ones? I was like, I've never hired you. Like, we've never even worked on a project together, like on a board or something like that. What do you want from me? Like, I think Christine has a great smile. I mean, like, what do people possibly want? So don't do that, guys. That's really annoying.
Yeah, reach out to people you've actually done work with, right. And they'll be more likely to write the recommendation. And don't use the generic template. Would you recommend me?
No, you want to put something specific in there.
Yeah.
And by the way, if you're ever approaching people like us, that our networks are pretty extensive and we meet a lot of people at speaking engagements and whatnot, is you do want to kind of mention like how, hey, remember Christine, we met at blank.
Yeah.
You know, whatever. Oh, yeah, okay. You know, because otherwise I'm going to have to look at your profile and go, man, I don't know, who's this person? And if I have to click on 5 things to figure out who you are, I'm probably just going to delete it.
You won't recognize her picture?
Yeah.
On LinkedIn? No.
I am really bad with names.
Oh, okay.
I'm just fundamentally...
Names and faces.
Oh. I might recognize your face, but I mean, that doesn't mean anything.
Yeah. Nice.
You know, on LinkedIn, there's also that... the new ones they've been doing, I think for the last 6 months, has been endorsing people's skills.
And those are cool.
Yeah. Those are really great. So you go into LinkedIn and click on the little flag icon. It'll show you who randomly just endorsed you for stuff in the last week. It's kind of bizarre.
And how, you know? I like it because it's telling you what first comes to mind when someone else is thinking
exactly.
about you.
Exactly.
What does everybody else think you're a specialist in? Because sometimes it's not what you think.
And sometimes they can actually add skills that you did not put on your profile.
Oh, you're right.
They could recommend you for other stuff. And that, I think that's actually the most valuable thing, is to, what do people know me as?
Mm-hmm.
You know, because you look at them and go like, that's not what I do. Like the top 5 things, you're like, oh my gosh, there's a branding issue now.
Yeah, branding, right? Messaging issue. Yeah. Like, what are you putting out there to make people think, oh, they're a specialist in sales, not marketing, not business, technology or whatever.
Yeah, you know, for a while, like, because for a couple of years, I was just, all my paid keynotes were off like social media. I was like, guys, I'm not a social media company.
So many people were
saying. A lot of people were tagging social media. I'm like, guys, I know about social media because it's a new world. It's the way we need to do business. But I'm not a social media company. It's not what I do.
Yeah.
But because we're getting booked after one talk was then booking some more, right? You're like.
Because someone's in the audience.
Yeah, you're like, oh, man.
It's like a chain, domino effect.
Which is great. But, you know, again, look at that. I think it's like number 5 on my thing. Like, that should not be anywhere.
What's the number 1?
Number 1, I think, is like leadership development kind of stuff.
Cool.
And then, like, I think, like, entrepreneurship or whatever. I was like, I don't know what does that mean? When you say their skill is entrepreneurship, like,
oh, see, I think that's one of my top ones, and I'm excited. That's what I want.
No, but what is that? What does that mean?
That just means
it
you're
means
all
that you're
about...
like an entrepreneur.
Yeah,
which is great because I am. I obviously am, but like, what does that even mean? My skill
Can
is entrepreneurship.
Cool.
On my resume, entrepreneurship.
I have a degree in entrepreneurship.
That's my fundamental skill. And another one on LinkedIn is, and it's a using like a group strategy. So there's 2 kinds of groups that I think you should join, and most people only choose the first kind, which is like in your trade industry, like in your segment.
Yeah.
So most people, their whole profile is all just people, all just groups that are within their space. But that's fine to build credibility in there, but that's kind of like everyone just, you know, that's not really your market. Choose a couple groups that have your prime, like ideal prospect in those kind of groups, and become an expert in there. It'd be really helpful. And be an expert. Most people, if you look at their LinkedIn, you're only allowed like 50 groups or something like that. All the groups are filled with things that have to do with the industry. It doesn't make any sense to me because you're not building. I think there should be like maybe 5 or 6 of the most important ones in your industry. Then the rest should all be groups that you're prospecting, I think.
No, definitely. You know? And then again, answering questions, asking questions.
Being super helpful.
Being super helpful.
You know, one thing that very credible experts do is they don't mind referring other people. So like in my answers, I'm not just going to talk about how great I am. I'm going to answer the question, and then I'm going to say, you know who else has information about this? Christine, right? People that do that, people just assume you're a big person. Like, oh, You're not petty.
Yeah.
Like, you're able to refer other people and shine, you know, share your spotlight with other people. And the other thing with group stuff is you're in the same group with someone. So say Christine and I, you and I are in the same group. But outside of the group thing, we're emailing back and forth through LinkedIn, talking about stuff. But what happens is we build that relationship outside of the group. And then when we get in the group, you find that people actively refer to you because you just had that conversation somewhere else.
It's like a virtual B&I group.
Basically.
That's what it
sounds
like.
Let me tell you where it showed up. Like, a couple folks, you know, reach out for me from different parts of the country, I think because of Your Biz Rocks, where they're like, hey, I just have some questions. I want to do what you used to do. What are some tips? And so we're talking about it. And then you'll see they flag my name in a group that I'm not even a part of. And say, hey, where I learned this from. They'll throw a comment, and then someone's like, that's great advice. Did you get it from a book or something? They're like, oh, I learned it from Joon Han. You know, blah, blah, blah. You're like, oh. And you just realize you're being brought into these other groups. Again, that's a credibility thing because you're just being helpful to people, you know. And for me, I get a lot of the same questions, so I just have templates. Yeah. Like, I have, like, FAQs that I keep in my email, you know, program. Just go, like, this person's asking about pricing. Here's everything I know about pricing.
Nice.
And now, you know, we can just reference Your Biz Rocks episodes.
That's true. That's what I've been doing a lot of lately, too. Like, I'm sure we have an episode on that.
Exactly.
We're almost coming up in a year.
Wow. Crazy. I know. We're going to have, like, some party
March,
for our whatever.
Better.
Our
party 50, time.
Our 52nd episode or
yes.
whatever it is. There's the, in TV, what's, like, the big one's, like, the 100th episode or something like that,
so,
where
yeah.
they usually kill off, like, a main character or something like that, so.
Hey, no, wait a minute.
And another thing, you know, we talked about with, like, you know, going back to books, videos, blogging, podcasts, that kind of stuff, is just basically doing presentations. Like, you and I do a lot of that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
You know? And sometimes it's in panels. Like, what would you say percentage-wise? Like, half of them are in panel settings and half of them is words.
Yeah, probably for me. I mean, I haven't done, just because of the new business launch, I haven't done anything in months. But, yeah, it's probably, like, 50-50. I always like panels because I even learn from them.
Yeah.
Like, people speaking on the panel, right. I'm kind of like, oh, taking notes on the side. And who have I told this to recently? People, we had a speaker come in to do a wellness workshop. And it's like, when you're on a stage, people automatically, when you are standing at a podium,
man.
When you're on
yeah.
top of a stage, you're automatically a credible source, just
right.
just off the bat, because you're standing in front of them and they're there in the
chair.
Also,
because most people wouldn't just get up in front of a crowd and just BS their way through.
Yeah.
That's the assumption, right? There
that's
are some
assumption.
People like that, but that's the assumption, right?
Yeah.
yeah
so
absolutely.
You're automatically, I mean, that is like this great credibility
right.
just right off the bat. So you need to embrace that. And when you're talking and speaking from the stage, you know, just make sure you're addressing, you know. It was one thing, it was funny, it was like she was saying, when people, she wasn't so much saying, you know, she works with tons and tons of people, but she was like, you know, it would have been a little bit better to say, you know, hey, when people, or when you work with me,
You don't want to, yeah.
She was saying,
people
when people work with me,
time,
or,
yeah.
you know, and I was like, no, you're the expert. Like, you just need to embrace, be up on that stage. Like, you know, just not be nervous and just know. So right off the bat, you're in the good graces
yeah.
of people that are already viewing you as an expert, and they don't even know you yet.
Here's another secret for using presentations as a credibility builder is that I generally will only say yes to, like, panels if someone else on there has a bigger network than me.
Why is that?
Because I want to get something out of it from my credit. I don't want to be the person giving credibility to everybody, which I'm happy to do. I want at least one person to be a little bit, like, have a little more status or experience than me. It's just something that I always feel like, you know, because I feel like I'm always giving back. I should be able to learn from other people as well, like you said, learning on panels. So I'll just look at everyone's networks and go, wow, that gal has a much more massive network than I do, or more Twitter followers, however you want to grade it, whatever, based on the panel. I go, I'll do that panel. Because they have more reach than I do, and there's something I can learn from them.
Oh, yeah,
sure.
That's true.
Yeah.
No, I'm a fan of panels. They're fun. I like it. They're fun. It's not just, like, all about me. It's, like, it's divided up with everybody on the panel, and it's different opinions and different views and different backgrounds.
And I think other than being the expert on, a platform or stage, the other real important credibility part is that you are now in a partnership with either a local, regional, or national organization. And I think that gives you credibility as well. Like, inherently, people think that organization is vouching for that person,
yeah.
right? If you're part of that event. So when you're partnering with organizations, people are like, oh, that's, you know, people don't think about, like, oh, that organization has nothing to do with my industry. They don't think that. They think, like, oh, that's like a nationally recognized group or regional mm-hmm. respectable organization, and they're partnered with that person. That's great. You know, that's how it works. You know? The last one is, I'll say this a couple things. One is, like, looking at, like, how Steve Jobs used to do his, like, big presentation, you know, once a year, kind of macro presentation kind of thing, that if you look at the amount of hours and like sheer number of people involved in picking the pictures, the only three words per sentence, the timing of it, how many hours Steve Jobs personally practiced, like on the actual stage of doing that. If you look at it, it's technically, you look at most businesses look at it and go, well, that was a really bad use of resources. Mm-hmm. But that was a very important forward-facing part of the business. And I think most business owners, because we're good at like doing our actual craft, our actual skill, we don't understand there's a forward-facing part of our business that we should treat just as ferocious and just as intense and, mm-hmm. and practice that. I mean, they spent a lot, I'm telling you, there was a massive team getting each one of those presentations together.
Do you know the hours offhand that they would spend?
No, but I know this. I know Steve Jobs spent the whole week before the presentation practicing. Think about that. This, think of how much his hours are worth.
Yeah.
And he's spending the whole week practicing. Actually, you know, I see a lot of guys when they practice the presentation, go, yeah, yeah, guys, so this is where I say this and this. Okay, move on. No, no, no. None of that for Steve Jobs. He's like, no, we're going to do
word.
It like we're going to
like
actually
script,
do it.
Like theater.
Practice it like it's theater. You know, and you don't have to be as dramatic as him, but you can see the difference between someone that put in hours on a forward-facing part of your business versus not. So this is like, you know, you'll see people like email websites, you know, typos or on videos. You don't act like you care. You're not excited about your business. You're just like, check, I did a video for my business. That's not going to work. You know, do a couple takes. Practice it. Look at yourself in the video and go, wow, let me change that before we post it on the public, you know, kind of stuff. Right. And the last one, I think you and I have mentioned this to a lot of like up-and-coming entrepreneurs, is that the biggest credibility builder you have is kind of how you feel about yourself.
Yeah.
You know, I remember the first like five clients I tried to get, I think I landed one of them, and every single one of them asked me for a reference, and I didn't have any. I had like character references, but I just started my company. I didn't have any references. Then all of a sudden, so I landed one client. My second client, through a friend of a good, really good friend of mine, was Stanford Department of Medicine, and that was a really hard job. They were asking for something I wasn't sure I could do, you know. But it was a friend of mine from college, a friend of my wife. So we took the job, and you know, I tried to over deliver and all that kind of stuff. I remember after I did a good job on that one, I got glowing recommendations from all these people like PhDs and, you know, budding Nobel laureates and stuff. And I was like, wow, that's an impressive group to get like praise from.
Yeah.
So I remember from that day forward, I said, man, I just can't wait till someone asks me for a reference, some like prospect. And you know what? From that day forward, no one has ever asked me for reference.
And you finally had some.
Right. I finally had like this super impressive one. And I think the only difference is because it's the way I talked about it.
Oh, okay.
You know? And so for all of you listening, there's got to be a point, and this is why I think the awards and stuff, they help, and doing presentations, because you realize someone else thinks you're good at it too.
Yeah.
Like you hopefully think you're good at it.
Yeah.
You know, but now someone else is vouching like, hey, we are all recognizing that you're good at this as well.
Nice.
You know,
so
that's a good, credibility builder for that kind of stuff. But again, I can't tell you what changed other than now that I had a great reference. And because that job was hard, and I actually did a good job, based on the feedback, I just thought like, wow, I must know what I'm doing, because these guys are like super smart. I gave them probably a disproportionate amount of, credibility or whatever, but that they thought I did a good job. I'm like, wow, I guess I did a good job.
And don't be afraid too to reach out, and maybe if you're a brand new business, especially. Get work for free or at a discounted rate in trade for like, okay, if you could write me, if you didn't like what I did, you're not going to write me a recommendation,
exactly.
But
exactly.
If you liked it, then, you know, would you be willing to do a video testimonial or written recommendation after we're done with the work?
Yeah.
Video just to kind of jumpstart that, and then you can start getting more clients based off of that.
Video is always stronger, but one of the things you're going to find out is most people suck in front of a camera. And so what they're saying might be awesome, but the way they're saying it is so awful, you're like, I don't know if we want to use that video testimonial. It's always stronger because it's a real person. You can see that that's a real person saying, you know, good stuff. But some people just come across really bad on video. You know? And so I asked some lady once, I'm like, hey, do you mind if I hire an actress to just read your testimonial? And she's like, yeah, as long as she's gorgeous. You know,
cool,
I'm like,
nice.
Okay, so this is Barbara. You know, I'm just like, it was a real testimonial,
because
it was based on that, but the person saying it wasn't the real person.
Oh,
so anyways, how do you guys feel about that? So obviously, I think if you went through this episode and just listed line by line, we got a lot of really great credibility builders for you. But I think again, Christina, I would say like a lot of it starts from you. You know, so these are all external things, but really, it's almost like, I don't know which one comes first. Do you start getting more of the other credibility things because you carry yourself a certain way, or do you carry yourself a different way because, you know, but no matter
what, the chicken before the
however it works, they're related, but I think no matter what, external stuff can't change how you feel about the value that you bring to people's lives and and their businesses and whatnot. So hopefully this made a lot of sense, a lot of practical ways you can increase your credibility. And that just means you're increasing your rates. You know, you're being able to cherry pick some of the better kind of customers and clients out there for you. So as always, you know, go ahead and sign up at yourbizrocks.com for extra bonus content.
And check us out on Facebook, Pinterest, and Twitter. And join us again next week to rock your biz.
Bye.
Bye.
Hey, it's me again, June, with this week's Expert Minute. And I have this great book. It came out in 2008 or 2009. So it's a little dated, but it's talking about some internet-specific marketing stuff. And it's called The Dirty Little Secrets of Buzz by David Seaman. And it's basically, it says how to attract massive attention for your business, your product, or yourself. So, you know, obviously, like, I'm not a household name, so it's not like, you know, we've done all this. But what's really inspiring about this book is that it has, man, it's great. So I'm trying to look at here. It has 62 specific secrets. And so it's just, you know, I think this guy just took what he used to do on blogs and stuff and just put it into a book format. And so it's just really inspiring. It's very practical. It's not a lot of theory. It's just 62 different tactics that to try. And, you know, I've tried maybe like 5 or 6 of them. And I realized, you know, I should be trying like maybe 10 to 20 of these a month. And so it's just, that's what I really find inspiring about that. What's surprising me is secret number 37. They talk about when you're doing, when you're trying to get publicity on like national radio shows or national even TV shows and stuff like that. One of the things to put at the bottom of all your materials is actually your landline phone number, because apparently that conveys a certain level of professionalism in dealing with the media, because especially radio shows, they are ultra sensitive of catching you on a cell phone when you're just somewhere and you know, it's cutting in and out, it's a horrible interview. I think you've probably heard radio shows just like I have where the guest is actually on, it's not in a studio, they're on the phone and they're on a cell phone, and it's horrible. So that was something really surprising, just some little thing like that saying, I have a landline phone. Again, you could be VOIP over the internet, but obviously just having a landline versus a cell phone, I think that's a big deal. So that was really surprising. I think something that I'm going to do differently is actually the fact that he gave, and again, some of them are dated, and so the tactics don't work anymore, but the concept, you can find a tactical equivalent just using the concept. And so, you know, again, it's only about 5 years old, but I would say about maybe a third of these, the actual platforms you talk about don't exist anymore, but something like that platform does exist online. And so one thing I will do going forward is to implement 10 or 15 of these a month. I don't, you know, I think if I was just 100% doing PR or marketing stuff, I could spend, you know, all month doing all 62 of these or finding their equivalent. And he has all this other stuff you can research even. He gives some helpful resources. But especially like building relationships and reaching out to popular blog sites, one of the best ways to do that is to be an active member or commenter on that blog and then reach out to them. So that just takes time. So that's definitely the two things that are going forward is try to implement 10 or 15 of these a month, as well as specifically reaching out and building relationships with other popular bloggers or other you know, popular Twitter folks. So hopefully that helps you out, and check out this book, Dirty Little Secrets of Buzz by David Seaman. So we'll catch you next time. Bye. Hey, welcome to this week's Viewer Mail, where Christina get one chance, one mighty swoop to answer your pressing business questions.
Yeah.
This one's really fun, I think. So Cliff, from here in San Diego, California, you both are very well respected here in the region. What's something people, I mean, apparently.
Okay, no, I know. So okay. I laughed.
I know. Thanks, Christine. What's something people would be surprised to know about you in your personal life and business life?
Okay.
None of your freaking business, Cliff. No, just kidding.
Nice. You want to take this on first? Yeah. You go first.
Okay, so in my business life, I'm a pretty easygoing guy, right?
Yeah.
But I'm actually really hard to work for. Like, I'm a pretty demanding
really?
Boss. Like, I have pretty exacting standards. If I'm giving you money to do something, you better be right on top of it.
Mad?
I don't know. I get very disappointed, and if you disappoint me a couple of times, then you're gone. It's just, because who has time to just keep reworking with someone? I mean, that's like an internship. Go somewhere else. Or my interns, I think I'm nice too. But if I'm like, you're on my paid project staff, or you're doing something, and you fail more than once on the same thing, gone. I don't care. You can be my son. You're gone. Now, my personal life, this was interesting. This is actually something that I'm always very open about when I do entrepreneur workshops, is that like, the reason it's important for me to make a substantial amount of money is I don't manage money very well. Like, we save and we're being responsible, but really, I mean, like, my wife and I, we're just spenders. We're like, oh, let's buy that. And then we go like, hey, you should buy that for yourself. It's awesome. It's like not a very good dynamic. Usually you have one person that's like, no, we should save, you know, but then you get fight conflicts and stuff. My wife and I are both like, hey, let's buy that. Or, yeah, that's a great deal. I'm glad you bought that. If we're just very spenders, so we don't have tons of financial discipline. So I've had to learn to do that over the years. It doesn't come naturally.
Yeah. So those are the two. So I'll start with the business one. People would be surprised. I mean, I'm happy-go-lucky, fun. Mm-hmm. I'm extremely hard on myself, probably more than people mm-hmm. think. Yeah. I'm, like, overly driven. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. I personally think it's a good thing, but I've had business colleagues and close friends of mine that are like, whoa, 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 scale it back.
But what are they doing?
They're all super successful people, so that's why I'm like, yeah, I don't know. I mean, this is my style.
I think most people are honest. They're harder.
I'm like pedal to the metal. Like, let's just like work so hard and just like make it happen and keep on pressing on. But we hit our goal last month by the 20th of the month. And instead of me celebrating and being like, yeah,
margaritas for everyone,
party, let me go on a vacation for the last 10 days of the month.
You still had 11 days left, right?
I said, oh, then that's not our goal anymore. Our goal, I jumped it one third up.
That was apparently too easy. You're like, that was too easy, team.
Yeah. I was like, oh, no. Now our goal is this. Yeah. So then I was like pressing just as hard, if not harder, to hit that goal because I decided that, like, oh, no, now. And I've done that before. Those were the Cleanology days. I used to be the exact same. I'm like, I don't change at all.
Yeah, I know.
So a lot of people are kind of surprised that I'm like, so super strict, so hard on myself. I work so hard. I don't know. That's just my style. But
you could take a couple more hours off.
Everybody tells me that. I like what I do, so that helps. But anyways, and then personally, I used to race cars when I was younger, and I had a street bike that I've gotten up to like 150 miles an hour, and I've gotten my car up to like 149. So I just I love driving fast.
Breaking the law.
I've broken the law. Yeah, that a million times. But what most people know is I just love driving. I love racing cars. I love going really fast. It's like the adrenaline. It's like the drug that runs through your, like skydiving. It's the same feeling, right?
Adrenaline,
I love adrenaline running through. I just like that feeling. So people are like, what, you had a street bike? Yeah, I was like, in my early 20s. I don't have one right now. I want one again.
Yeah, how come you don't have a bike now?
I want one so bad,
it's and it's such a little gas on that bad boy.
No, I know, but it's like a gut. Like, I'm real big on intuition, and my intuition told me to sell it. You know, like 6 years ago, I just knew that my time. It's when you're riding a street bike. It's not if you're gonna lay it down. It's when.
It's when you're gonna land on your leg and crush your half of your body.
Yeah, or scar. You know, and scars are cool on guys, but they're not as cool on women. So. There you go, Cliff.
All right, Cliff. Hopefully it made a lot of sense. And I don't think we're going to make a full episode of that one, but that was a great question nonetheless. Yeah. So thanks for sending it in, and we'll check you guys next week. Bye.
Bye.